The Rust ecosystem has a wealth of tools that support us when writing Rust, but there are two important tools I want to talk about before we get back to the real programming: Rust Format and Clippy. As ever, this series is accompanied by a free book. Check the description for a link straight to this chapter. My name is Daniel. Welcome to Iris. Rust Format helps us keep our code styles consistent so that it's easy to share our code or read and learn from someone else's. Clippy helps us spot common mistakes and anti-patterns and can even make suggestions on things like performance, scalability, or readability improvements. But this is a lot of tools. How can we use them to not only improve our code, but learn to be better developers? Let's go through them one by one. Rust Format is a formatting tool for Rust. Programming language formatting tools allow you to configure how you want your code to look. For example, do you like opening curly brackets on the end of a line or on a new line? Do you indent with four spaces or two? Does the last item in a list across multiple lines have a trailing comma or not? How many empty lines are allowed between lines of code in a function? And so on. Maintaining a consistent style improves the legibility of code, making it faster for engineers to read and understand what's happening. This is true even if you only write code for yourself. Using familiar patterns reduces the cognitive load to parse what you're looking at. When working together as a group, it's important to come to an agreement as to how you'll style your code together, but luckily, a formatter will reduce the burden of having to maintain the style once you've picked what to use. Now, different languages have different styles that they'll follow. Some older languages may have multiple well-established styles to choose from. Luckily, there's an official Rust style guide, which gives us all a compelling reason to write code the same way. Not only that, but Rust Format comes with the tool suite and will automatically maintain the style for you. You can call Rust Format manually using cargo format and it'll automatically reformat your entire project. However, it's definitely best if you can set your IDE to automatically run it anytime you save a file. This will save us any big unexpected changes. If you just want it to simply tell you if anything is incorrectly formatted without changing your files, you can use cargo format --check. We'll come back to why this is so useful later. Finally, it might be that you and your team find some aspect of the official Rust style guide particularly egregious, and that's fine. Been there, believe me. Rust Format allows you to configure how it will format your code through Rust TOML. You can find a complete guide to what you can control on the Rust Format GitHub page, which I've linked in the description. Clippy is a name that might bring a lot of anxiety to millennials and boomers or anyone working with Microsoft Office around the turn of the century. And yes, this Clippy is named after that one. Clippy in this case is Rust's linter, a tool that can not only make sure your code is correct, I mean, Rust C technically already does that for you, but even offer suggestions on how to improve your code and explain why an alternative might be better. To run Clippy with the default configuration, simply type cargo Clippy. This is an incredibly powerful tool, not just for making sure your code is the best it can be, but as an aid for learning how to get the best out of Rust. Perhaps antithetical to that, though still incredibly useful, Clippy can go right ahead and fix many of the common issues it might find simply by passing the --fix flag. Obviously, I recommend making sure you understand the changes it's suggesting before allowing it to proceed. But Clippy won't just check your code. It can also spot mistakes in your documentation. We love documentation here, if you couldn't tell. For example, if in your doc comments you use underscores or double colons outside of backticks, which would be used to express code, Clippy will assume this is a mistake and let you know about it. There's a lot of flexibility in how you can configure Clippy. Lints are broken up into groups for easy control, so we typically might decide at the group level what to include and whether it should be considered a warning or completely denied. For example, I tend to include a group of lints called pedantic with a warning. These are usually allowed by Clippy, which means you won't get told if there's a potential issue. I don't particularly recommend starting with this group of lints, but if you want to do this, you can either add the line warn Clippy pedantic to your project entry point, or run cargo clippy dash dash space dash capital W clippy pedantic. The benefit of the first option is that you can set a nice default for the project without you or anyone else needing to remember what options to pass clippy. The latter is useful if you want to override that or any other behavior. For a full list of lints, check Clippy's website. I've linked it in the description. There's one last tool I want to mention, and it will initially seem quite underwhelming by comparison to the others, but stick with me. CargoCheck is a tool which checks your code and all its dependencies for errors. Groundbreaking, right? I mean, we'd find out that our code has errors when we try to build it with cargo build. So what's the point of cargo check? Well, cargo check essentially does the same job as cargo build, but skips the final step of code generation. This means it's faster and importantly cheaper to perform, so it can be used as a fast fail. The work it does isn't wasted either. Because it does in fact perform some of the compilation steps, the output of this is cached on your machine so that other tools, such as cargo build and Clippy, can use that to skip earlier steps in their own processes. This might not seem very useful on your machine, but it comes in very handy with continuous integration. Continuous integration, or CI, is a technique that we use to maintain high quality, robust, and correct code in our codebase. CI is usually used to help control what goes into your version control system, or VCS, where you might be storing your code. Systems like Git, Mercurial, Subversion, etc. are all out of scope of the series. However, if you haven't already, you should learn to use one of these as quickly as possible. I can't tell you which to use though, as it depends on what kind of application you're building. Git is very common and is what I use for most things, including managing these scripts, but it's better for things that are primarily built from text-based resources like websites or desktop applications. If you're making games or something that uses a lot of images or other non-text-based assets though, you might want to use Subversion, Plastic, or Perforce. Whatever you choose, you can use continuous integration to make sure that every time you make changes, those changes make your project better and minimize the risk of them making things worse. How you achieve this will vary depending not only on what VCS you use, but potentially who hosts it. GitLab and GitHub are both Git services, but GitLab CI is very different from GitHub Actions. The main idea, however, is to run a set of instructions before allowing changes to be integrated or merged into the main project. For example, a typical Git workflow might begin with a main branch. When you come to do some work, you'd create a new branch based on what's currently in main and name it something relevant to the work you're going to do. For example, when I wrote this chapter of the book, I was on a branch called Clippy and Format. When you're happy with your code, you would merge your branch with main, and main would get all of your changes. This is where CI helps. It makes sure that whatever you're doing on your branch is up to the level of quality that is expected of code in main. We can use the tools we've talked about in this and previous videos to create a CI workflow. Roughly, what we want to do is run cargo check. If this fails, there's not a lot of point in continuing, so we get our results faster. Run cargo format dash dash check, which will make sure our code abides by our style guide without changing anything. Run cargo clippy dash 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 D warnings, which errors out if there are any warnings from Clippy. Remember, although warnings don't necessarily mean that something is actually wrong, you should try to make sure to fix them all anyway, as the more irrelevant warnings you're outputting, the more likely it is that you'll miss something that is relevant. Cargo test will run all of our tests and doc tests. Cargo build will make sure our code actually compiles. This can also be very useful in a continuous deployment technique where, after merging to main, we could automatically deploy our latest code. Running all of this at once, one after the other, can be very time consuming, but some of it can be run in parallel. Cargo check and cargo format don't depend on anything else, and they can act as fast fails, letting us know that it's not worth continuing the process. Cargo test and cargo clippy are only going to work if cargo check also works, so as soon as cargo check is complete, we can start working on them. Finally, once cargo test and cargo clippy have succeeded, we can move to the final cargo build. At this point, everything that could be caught should have been caught, so there should be no more surprises, which means that we might as well wait for cargo format to be complete too. Depending on your CI suite though, it might be that each of these tasks runs in isolation. For example, it might run each step in a Docker container. But cargo check is going to do a lot of hard work some of the other steps can use. This is where it's worth learning your CI suite's caching process so that you can cache the output of the cargo check step. I know I keep saying you don't pay software engineers to code, you pay us to solve problems, but we usually solve those problems with code, so it's about time we get back to it. Next time, we're going to look at adding functionality to types with everyone's favorite guest star. If that sounds good, don't forget to like and subscribe. Finally, there's now a Patreon and more importantly, a Discord server, so come join our growing community. And if I don't see you there, I'll see you next time.